Hi everyone, my name is Mark DeJong, and in this video, we will continue to explore the history of the bass in jazz. In part one of this series, we briefly examined such names as Pop Foster, Bill Johnson, Wellman Broe, and Walter Page. In this video, we will begin with a musician who was influenced by his early exposure to music in the church, yet was equally inspired by the compositions of the great Duke Ellington. I'm referring to the bass virtuoso, composer, and bandleader, Charles Mingus. Mingus was born in Nogales, Arizona on April 22, 1922, and spent his early years growing up in the Watts neighborhood of Los Angeles. As a child, he was often immersed in the musically and spiritually expressive atmosphere of the Holiness Church, and soon convinced his father to order him a trombone for Christmas from the Sears Roebuck catalog. He first encountered the music of Ellington via a radio broadcast of East St. Louis Tootaloo, and was inspired by Ellington trombone master Tricky Sam Nanton. He began studies with local trombonist Britt Woodman, who recognized Mingus' extraordinary ear, but suggested he might be better suited to a string instrument. Mingus chose the cello, and soon he had advanced his skills enough to play in the Los Angeles Junior Philharmonic. But his focus soon switched to bass, as his friend and mentor, Buddy Collette, mentioned the Jordan High School jazz band needed a bassist, and Mingus never looked back. After some bass studies with local bassist Red Callender, an additional study on piano and theory with Lloyd Reese, who taught numerous notable LA musicians like Dexter Gordon, Buddy Collette, and Eric Dolphy, Mingus would begin building his musical resume with such notable names as Roy Eldridge, Louis Armstrong, and Kid Ory. After a brief trip to Canada with Armstrong, Mingus returned to Los Angeles and began bass studies with former New York Philharmonic bassist Herman Reinshagen, who guided Mingus to become one of the premier jazz-based virtuosos. Soon he was playing regularly in various clubs around Central LA with the likes of Lee Young and Dexter Gordon. Following stints with Lionel Hampton, Billie Holiday, Red Norvo, and others, Mingus, at the age of 28, decided to move to New York City. Soon he was a top-call bassist, performing with the likes of Billy Taylor, Max Roach, Charlie Parker, Bud Powell, and others. Mingus formed a record label in 1952 and was with Parker when the famous Massey Hall concert took place in Toronto, Canada, often referred to as the greatest jazz concert ever. He won the Downbeat New Star Bassist poll in 1953, and the following year formed the Jazz Composers Workshop. Soon, his skills as a bandleader would gain wide acclaim in the latter years of the decade, with recordings such as Pithecanthropus Erectus, The Clown, Blues and Roots, and Mingus A-Um. Mingus would enjoy critical success beyond the border, with notable appearances in Europe with his touring bands that included saxophonist Eric Dolphy and drummer Danny Richmond. Other notable recordings by Mingus include The Black Saint and the Sinner Lady, Mingus, 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 and Changes One and Changes Two. Later in his life, he collaborated with legendary Canadian singer Joni Mitchell on Mingus, an album featuring four of his compositions. At the time of the recording, Mingus was suffering from advanced stages of ALS, and he passed away just prior to its completion on January 5th, 1979. Here is Winnipeg bassist Lindsay Woolgar to play the Charles Mingus composition, Better Get It In Your Soul. Thank you. bassist we will examine was a contemporary of Mingus and had a deep melodic sense accentuated by his rich tone and clarity of articulation. I'm referring to the innovative bassist Oscar Pettiford. Pettiford was born of mixed African and Native American ancestry in Okmulgee, Oklahoma in 1922. Pettiford showed an early affinity for music performance, as evidenced by his dancing and lead vocals with his family band by age 10. At 14 years of age, he began playing the upright bass and soon came under the influence of Ellington bassist Jimmy Blanton, as well as The Judge bassist Milt Hinton. After relocating to Minneapolis, one of his earliest professional engagements was with bandleader Charlie Barnett, and soon after appeared with jazz saxophonist Coleman Hawkins on the recording The Man I Love. He moved to New York City in 1943 and soon joined the cadre of bebop innovators at Minton's Playhouse and gigged regularly with the likes of Thelonious Monk, Roy Eldridge, Errol Garner, Max Roach, as well as co-leading a band with Dizzy Gillespie. He joined the Ellington Band in 1945, remaining with the legendary bandleader for 3 years. During his stint with Ellington, he became one of the first to incorporate the sound of the cello in jazz. After playing with Woody Herman in 1949, Pettiford began to establish himself as a bandleader, making records for several labels, including Debut and ABC Paramount. In the mid-1950s, he would lead groups of various sizes, including sextets, big bands, and orchestra, where he collaborated with composer G.G. Grice. Several of his tunes have become part of the standard repertoire of jazz, including Bohemia After Dark and Trichotism. In 1958, Pettiford went to Europe on tour with the Carnegie Hall Jazz Band and was so enraptured by the lifestyle there, he decided to move to Copenhagen. He would perform regularly with other American expat musicians, such as Stan Getz, Bud Powell, and Kenny Clarke, as well as other leading European musicians who were on the scene. Following a performance at a club in 1960, he went to the hospital feeling unwell and died the next day of a viral infection at the age of 37. Once again, here is Winnipeg bassist Lindsay Woolgar to play the Oscar Pettiford tune, Trichotism.